Well, good morning, everyone. A really warm welcome to our service this morning. We're so glad that you could come out to join us today at Millbrook Church of the Nazarene. You're very, very welcome. Those that are here in person and those that are online, equally very welcome as we worship together this morning. Let's stand together as we begin our service and sing "The Battle Belongs." Sing through the night, oh God, the battle belongs to you. And if you are for me, who can be against me? For Jesus, there's nothing impossible. You see the beauty. When all I see is a cross gone, you see the empty tomb. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees, my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs. I'll sing through the night, oh God, the battle belongs to you. Oh mighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Oh, mighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Oh, mighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees, my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Let's just open this morning with a word of prayer. Let's pray together.
Our Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you for this, your day. Lord, we just thank you that we can come to freely worship you this morning. Lord, we just thank you for each member of our congregation, Lord, that's here this morning, and those that aren't here. We just pray that your hand will be upon them, Lord. We pray that you'll be all that they need you to be to them this morning, Lord, whether that's a comforting touch, Lord, or a healing touch, Lord, that you will be all that they need this morning, Lord. We're just so thankful for your mercy and your goodness to us. Lord, we just thank you for your presence that's here this morning, Lord, and the fact that we share that with you. And we just pray this morning as we continue your worship that you will be here with us as we hear from Pastor Ruth and we hear the word of God this morning, that you will help that to penetrate our hearts, Lord. Help us to be challenged by what we hear, Lord, and changed, Lord, and encouraged by what we hear through your word this morning. Help it to allow it for us to apply it to our lives, Lord, that we can go out different than when we came in. Lord, we just pray for your continued presence with us as we worship, Lord. We know that you're here, and we just are reminded, Lord, of all the things that happen this time of year as we begin our programs again, Lord, and as people are back to school and people get back into routine of things at this time. We just pray that you'll be with each of us, Lord. Help us to be aware of your presence as we do it, Lord, and that you will help us just to be a witness for you in the places that we are. We just pray all these things now in your name's sake. Amen. So you are very welcome to your service, and thanks for all those that have come out here this morning. We do still have a few announcements just to make, and just to remind you that we are allowed to have some more people here in our church service, and if you're unsure about booking in, please don't be fretting about that. Please do book in and come and join us this morning. So remember to book online to join us. Next Sunday, Rhonda's going to give an announcement regarding our Sunday school. We were hoping to have some program back for next week of some sort. So keep an eye on the Millbrook Naz social media pages, and you'll find out just exactly for the Sunday school, the plans for that. A reminder that we have our prayer meeting on a Wednesday evening at 8 p.m. On Zoom. You're very welcome to that. We'd love to see more people join us for that. So if you're able to, it's 30 minutes or so at 8 o'clock on a Wednesday night. Please do join us. The details of the meeting, Zoom meeting information and the password, etc., will be on our social media as well. So keep an eye for that. And the next men's event, just a bit in the future, is the 7th of October. Keep an eye for further announcements about that at 7 p.m., a games night. And we're going to have the Reverend Philip McAllister as a guest speaker for that. So you can put that date in your diary for the men's next evening. So that's all the announcements I have. We're going to continue our worship. We'll sing another couple of songs before we invite Ruth up to speak. Let's stand together as we sing.
Look inside the mystery, see the empty cross, see the risen Savior, victorious and strong, and no one else above him, and none as strong to save. He alone has conquered the power of the grave. Glorious, my eyes have seen the glory of the Lord. Glorious, he stands above the rulers of the earth. Look beyond the tombstone, see the living God, see the resurrected, the ruler of my heart. No one else above him, to match his word, the hope of his returning that fills the universe. Glory. He stands above the rulers of the earth. Glorious, glorious, Lord, you are, and
sin, Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. Arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Today there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. Arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, what a Savior! Isn't he wonderful? Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen. Bow down before him, for he is Lord of all. Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen. Oh, what a Savior. Isn't he wonderful? Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen.
was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Bear your cross as you wait for the crown. Tell the world of the treasure you found.
You may take your seats.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Everybody, it is so good to see you in God's house today. It's lovely to have you with us. Let's just come to the throne of God in prayer. Father, we thank you that we can come to the altar, that we can lay down our regrets and mistakes, that we can come to you as we are. We pray, Lord, that as we leave, we would be as you have called us to be. Father, Lord, we pray as we come to your word that you would just close us in now. We pray, Lord, that you would help us to hear from you. Father, I give you permission to speak to my heart today. I pray, Lord, that as individuals and as your church gathered, that we would give you permission to speak to our hearts, to challenge, to change, to refresh, renew, restore, to convict, to convince, whatever it is, Lord. We give you permission not just to speak to us, Lord, but to equip us and to help us to become the people that you've called us to be. We pray these things in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen. Well, it's hard to believe that this is the end of the series of the Gospels. John is the last Gospel, and we are in the concluding sermon of that. But not only is it the end of the Gospels, it's also the beginning of our next series. I don't know if you remember this, but we actually started Genesis in January 2019. We've made some progress, a little bit, and we are now on the 5th of September 2021 at the end of the Gospels. But you know that we have to get the whole way to Revelation. The Bible doesn't finish at John, and neither do we. So we have still a little way to go. But we are finishing the Gospel series today, but also launching a new series called Journey of Grace. Journey of Grace is based around the last I am, so what a great way to end one and begin another with I am the way, the truth, and the life. Journey to Grace is looking at how we belong to God, but not only how we belong to God, but how we belong to each other and how we find maturity in Christ. It really is a discipleship series, and it's been launched by the Church of the Nazarene, and the churches in Northern Ireland are going to start it this week and next week, and hopefully then in the mainland they're going to start their program in January as well. So we're really excited to see what God has in store for us. But today, we're going to finish with John and the last I am. Not the last I am in John, but the last one for us. I think Lucy went through the last ones chronologically. Today, we're going to look at the I am the way, the truth, and the life. I realized I had that glass of water and didn't drink anything. Now, I know that you know, because I've already told you, whether you remember it or not is a different thing. I know that you already know that the Bible, when it was originally written, it was not written in chapters and verses. Now, you know that because I've told you. If you remember that, nod your head. If you don't remember, just nod anyway. You know, I like the participation. It wasn't written in chapters and verses. That was added in later on. And there are some lovely things about the chapters and verses that have been added in later. So, for example, isn't it really lovely to be able to say, here's a verse that changed my life? You see, for me, it is actually found in John's Gospel as well. Whenever God called me into ministry and I was really doubting that call and struggling with it, and my reading that day was, I have called you, you have not called me, and I go and bear fruit, fruit that will last. And it's so lovely for me to be able to go back to that verse, those verses in Isaiah. Don't we love to be able to quote them? Fear not, for I am with you. I am your Lord. I will strengthen you. We love that, and that is a great benefit of us that we know it's chapter and verse. Sometimes we lose a little bit in the reading. And that's what's kind of in that, the separation of chapter and verse, because we think that a new section has begun, but actually it's a whole story, and that's where we are today. In a few moments, I'm going to read one of the most famous passages, and you will already know it, the part where Jesus says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled," but it begins at a chapter. And so we kind of think, well, if it begins at a chapter, that must be a new day or a new sermon or a new section. But actually, it's in the middle of a story. Now, you remember I've said to you, and I know you'll remember, because you remember every sermon. Do you remember I said to you that in John, there are no parables, there are no Kingdom of God sermons, there's no Sermon on the Mount, there's no Beatitudes? But actually, there is one discourse in it that is really important. There is one communication with Jesus and his 12 disciples. It's called the Upper Room Discourse. And that is the beginning of the story. We find it in John chapter 13, and here we are in the upper room, not crowds, not religious leaders, not people who are coming to be healed, just Jesus and his closest followers. There's 13 of them in that upper room, maybe a few more, Jesus and the 12. They're about to celebrate Passover together, and Jesus knows that they're in Jerusalem. He knows what's about to happen, and he knows that everything is about to change, and so he begins to speak to his disciples, and here is the sermon that he gives them. In fact, it doesn't begin with words. Chapter 13 begins with this picture in the upper room as Jesus knows what's about to happen. And so he takes off his coat and he gathers a towel and he puts it in his belt and he kneels down with a jug of water and begins to wash his disciples' feet. The beginning of the sermon in John is an action. It's not words. It's the moment where the teacher and the rabbi becomes the servant. The king of all creation bends down and washes the disciples' feet. I imagine it was a little bit awkward. There's that moment when Peter says, "No, no, no, you can't be washing my feet." And Jesus says, "I have to." And there's that whole conversation. And then Peter ends up saying, "Well, wash all of me." And Jesus is showing them, well, actually, to lead, you've got to learn how to serve. This is the kingdom talk in John, that the first shall be last and the last shall be first. And in those awkward moments, Jesus washes the feet of his disciples. So the evening in the upper room begins with dirty feet. It's a little bit awkward. And that's just the beginning. It's just the beginning of an uncomfortable evening. You see, the next thing to happen is this, that Jesus says, "I'm going to tell you this next part. And the reason that I'm telling you that this next part before it happens is so that you know I am who I am." Now, we've heard those words before. I am frightened to ask you for the answer. But we've heard those words before in Exodus, with Moses at the burning bush. You're agreeing with me. And we hear God say, "I am who I am, Iyah, Asher, Iyah." We hear those words. We've heard them before. I am God. So you imagine they've just had their feet washed. They're in their upper room, and they hear Jesus say, "I'm about to tell you something. I'm going to tell you before it happens. I'm going to tell you this so that you will know I am who I am." And they all lean forward in their chairs, and the room falls silent, and they're waiting for this revelational truth. And here it comes. One of you will betray me. One of you who has walked this journey with me for the last three years, my friends, my closest followers, in this moment, here is what I'm telling you so that you will know when it happens that I am still God. One of you will betray me. And Judas leaves the room. They're now down to 11 and Jesus with maybe a few others. All of a sudden, the feet washing seems very comfortable in that revelation. And they hear the words that someone is going to betray Jesus. They see Judas leave the room. And then all of a sudden, the news gets even worse. These are the words of Jesus in John. I'm going to leave you very soon. It wasn't what they wanted to hear. I'm going to leave you very soon, and you're not going to be able to come with me. So there's that whole feet washing, there's betrayal, and now Jesus is going to leave. What are we going to do? We've been with him every single day. We've based our whole lives on him. And now he said he's going to go. And Peter says, oh, Lord, you can't go anywhere that I'm not going to go. In fact, I will be with you every single place that you go, and I will even lay down my life for you. And Jesus says, more bad news. Peter, before the rooster crows three times tomorrow morning, you will have denied me three times. The jaws hit the floor. The silence is palpable. Tension fills the room, and their hearts are so confused and so, so troubled. The King of Kings becomes a servant. Their friend Judas is plotting betrayal. Jesus is about to leave them. Peter is going to deny him not just once, but three times. And in the middle of all these revelations, in that disappointment, in that real agitation, we come to John chapter 14, and this is what Jesus says of verse 1. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. There is more than enough room in my Father's house. If it were not so, I would have told you. And I'm going to prepare a place for you. When everything is ready, I will come and get you so that you will be with me where I am always. And you know the way to where I am going. No, we don't know, Lord. We don't know, Thomas said. We have no idea where you're going. So how can we know the way? And Jesus told him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except by me. You have already known me. You would know, if you know me, you know who the Father is. And from now on, you do know him and have seen him. Here it is, the last I am. You know, whenever Jesus says, I am who I am, and we go back to that part where Moses hears those words from God in that burning bush, the Iyah Asher Ai. Well, there is that Hebrew phrase in there, that Iyah Asher Ai, and actually it reflects and is similar to, in Hebrew, the very holy name of God. And that would not have been lost on the Jewish people in that room tonight. Iyah, I am Yahweh. Iyah, Yahweh, I am God. And those words reflect and they combine with each other. And the picture is this, that in that brokenness, I am still God. I am the way, the truth, and the life. And you see, because he puts the I am in front of the way, the truth, and the life, that I am in front of the way, the truth, and the life, that adds that godly divinity. And so that means not only is he the way, the truth, and the life, he is actually the only way, the only truth, and the only life. Those are words that are not always welcome today. But when he says, Yahweh, the way. Yahweh, the truth. Yahweh, the life. I am the only way. I am the truth itself. I am life itself. Now, here's something that struck me in this passage that I'd probably never thought about before. In fact, I hadn't. I'm just going to tell you the truth. I never thought about this part before. When we hear those words, I am the way, the truth, and the life, that are so famous for us, that we have based our mission on, that we know that Jesus is the way, when we hear those words, I never realized that they were said in private. I always thought, you know, when you see them in those pictures, I am the way, the truth, and the life, with the street sign and the arrow going this way. You've all had one from Sunday school. I always imagined, and I don't know why, that they were always really public words. And I think Jesus probably should have said them publicly. You know that time whenever he turns up at the temple and he says to them, you've made my father's house into a den of thieves, and he shoos them all out. He should have taken that moment to say, don't you get it? I am the way, the truth, and the life. What a dramatic scene that would have been. You know, I think that that's probably where he should have said it. Or maybe that time, do you know whenever he says, I'm the bread of heaven, because they're all moaning because he didn't make lunch 2 days in a row. They turned up because he'd done the whole thing with the fish and the loaves, and they wanted to see it again. They wanted the Moses and the manna. They didn't want the Messiah. And he said, don't you get it? I am the bread of heaven. And I am the way, the truth, and the life. What a moment that would have been. Imagine if he had said it then. Do you know when he was with the Pharisees and he was saying, the reason you don't get it, the reason you don't recognize me is because I'm not your shepherd, because my sheep hear my voice. I am the good shepherd. In fact, I am the gate. I'll lay down my life in that gate so that no one will touch my sheep. I'm the good shepherd. I am the gate. In fact, and right there in the Pharisees' faces, I am the way, the truth, and the life. But that's not where he said it. It wasn't this amazing declaration in the midst of the enemy or in the crowd. It was in the brokenness, in the tenderness, in the fear of a moment with his friends. Those words have become the disciples' sermons. I am the way, the truth, and the life. They became their mission as they left that upper room. And as Jesus ascended back into heaven, they remembered that moment significantly. And that is what they based their gospel story on, the way, the truth, and the life. But here's how it started out. It started out in an upper room filled with confusion. It started out in the middle of fear, in the height of trouble. In the middle of a picture that was going to get even worse. And Jesus reminds them in that trouble, I am the way. Stick to this plan. I am the truth. No matter what happens, I'm still the truth. And I am life. No matter what you're about to see, remember those words, I am still the life. And as they remembered those words, trouble began to rain down. It was like Jesus was saying to them in that upper room, like, things are about to get really tough here. They're going to get so tough that you're going to doubt yourself. But I am still the way. And Jesus, knowing that he was going to be tortured and crucified, do you know what else he knew? He knew that they were going to doubt him too. But he is still the truth. And he knew in that denial of Peter that they were going to get it wrong many times. But he wanted to remind them to come back because he is still the life. The gospel in a nutshell, isn't it really? I am the way, the truth, and the life. It's the story of Jesus, the foundation of our mission, that part of the hope that comes to us, that we know that we are following the true God. He is the way, the truth, and the life, the only way, the only truth, the only life. It is our hope. But the truth of it all is that that hope started in chaos. Those words of hope were brought in a time of trouble, a scene of despair and confusion, of mistrust and disappointment. Now, I know that you know because I told you, and I know that you remember every single sermon. But you remember I told you that something was lost in the Hebrew translation when it comes into English. So I think that from next week, we should just learn Hebrew. You see, Hebrew doesn't work in that past, present, and future tense, that I am, I was, and I will be. That's not how it works. For Hebrew, those words are action words. They are eternal words. They are forever words. So in that one phrase, Eya, Asher, Eya, there is the past, the present, and the future. So it equates to what happened then in that room, but it is right now, and it will hold us in the future too. These words are eternal. I just want to remind you this morning that the words of Jesus have never been silenced, and they never are, and they never will be. And in that room, they heard these words, and they got the whole picture yesterday, today, forever. I am the way, the truth, and the life. And they got it, but sometimes we lose a little bit in that. Do you know what that means for us? That in this world that is chaotic today, in this world that has so many tragedies today, in this world that is full of mistrust and disappointment and concern and confusion, do you know what the story of our hope is? He is still the way, the truth, and the life. And you know what tomorrow holds? No, only this, that he will still be the way, the truth, and the life. The world seems pretty chaotic at the minute. It seems incredibly broken, but the words of Jesus are still true. But what about you and me? Because the context of I am the way, the truth, and the life was given in that personal space of the upper room, in that close setting of a group of friends. What about us in that upper room? In those moments where we're crushed by betrayal, in those moments where we are disappointed beyond belief, in those moments where we have let Jesus down, what about those upper room moments? Well, the hope still goes on. It is as true today as it was then, and Jesus still says, I am Yahweh, Iyah, the way. I am the truth. I am life itself. Do you know what I pray this morning for us? That this becomes our foundational truth, the one on which we rest today and tomorrow and the next day, that we would know that he and that we would follow in his steps, that we would know that he is the truth and we would live by his, by the beautiful way that he has set out for us to live, that we would know that he is the life and that we would live it abundantly. And I pray that this would just be the beginning, that as we venture forward into the way that he set for us to walk, knowing the truth that he has taught us, that we would live the life that he has called us to. For in the upper room, he is still the way. In this world, he is still the truth. In our day and in our tomorrow, he is still life. I pray that those words would fill our hearts. I pray that they would bring hope as they brought the disciples hope. I pray that they would bring mission just as they brought the disciples mission. And I pray that if you are in that upper room, that you would hear those words. Don't let your heart be troubled. believe in me. I'm going to my Father's house and I'm making room for you, and I'm going to come back again, and you're going to be with me always. You don't really know how that's going to happen, but let me tell you, I am the way, and I am the truth, and I am life itself. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that you are so gracious, so loving, so kind, that you have given us a way not just to find you, Lord, but to be with you, that you have made us your children. Lord, we thank you that you have set a truth before us and how you have taught us to live our lives. May we be the people that you've called us to be so that we can be the church that the world needs us to be. We thank you, Lord, that you give life abundantly. We thank you, Lord, for the beauty of the hope that you give us. We are reminded that this hope was given in a time of trouble. And Lord, some of us feel like we're in a time of trouble today. We pray that we would hear your words, that you would take away anxiety and pour in your peace. Lord, that you would look in our trouble and you would just say, it's okay. I am still the way. I am still the truth. I am still the life. Thank you for these words of hope. Lord, may we live them out every day. May they fill our hearts. May we live our lives as a reflection of these great words of hope. And we thank you, Lord, for all that you've done. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Let's stand together as we sing our closing song.
You reach from the sky, leaving heaven's throne. I was meant to die. The riches of your grace I could not afford, asking for a taste, you gave me so much more. Oh, what a price you pay, trading the highest place, lay down your crown. Up everything that you would die for me. How great a king. From death life has begun, a garden can break. Hope has risen up, your name is victory. Your name is victory. Oh, what a price you pay, trading the highest place. Lay down your crown for me. How great a king. Oh, what a life you gave. You gave up you would die for me. How great a king. How great a king. for all you are and all you've done. We lift you up, lift you up, for all you are and all you've done. We lift you up, lift you up, for all you are and all you've done. We lift you up, lift you up, for all you are and all you've done. We lift you up, lift you up, for all you are and all you've done. We lift you up, lift you up, for all you are and all you've done. We lift you up. Oh, what a price you paid, trading the highest place. Lay down your crown.
Father, we thank you for our time together this morning, Lord, and we thank you for the word that we've heard. We just pray that you'll help it to bless it to our hearts, Lord. Help us as we apply it this week in our lives. We ask all these things now in your name's sake, we pray.